Hello viewers, welcome to AcadHelp Bio webinar. Today our discussion is on human reproduction. Since this is a very large topic, we'll be conducting this discussion in two phases. Today we'll be doing with the first part, and you are already aware of our eminent teachers, those who are our guests, Rajiv Singh, Sabyasachi Majumdar, Gautam Biswas. Already I have introduced you. Now let's start our discussion. So welcome all of you. Welcome the guests, the panelists.
Thank you.
And welcome the viewers. Let me tell you that we are dedicated for our children to improve the quality of biology learning. Apart from regular classes, various videos, we have planned to organize such webinars where we can identify and then invite eminent teachers and their views, their teachings, their concepts can be given to you. So instead of learning from one single teacher, here we can hear opinions and the ideas of different teachers. And these teachers are eminent and selected teachers. So welcome all of you. And let's begin with some very important questions which are being frequently asked by our students. Recently, we have received some mails and they want some clarifications. So may I now start with a very simple question? That is, students are very much confused with two terms. One is primary sex organ and secondary sex organs. Before this, let me tell you that since we are dealing with the chapter now, human reproduction, and humans are sexually reproducing organisms, and the total events includes various or events of reproduction, we will be discussing the various organs, the male and the female organs, gametogenesis, insemination, and thereafter up to the parturition. Today we will not have time to discuss all of those. So we will again meet as soon as possible with the second part. So today let us first start with what are primary sex organs, and let us try to identify them, understand them, and try to differentiate between secondary sex organs. So the first question is primary sex organs and secondary sex organs. Please, may I ask Dr. Majumdar?
So basically the gonads, they are the primary sex organ. That means in case of male, we have testis as the primary sex organ. Along with that, the other secondary organs include the accessory ducts like vasa deferentia, vasa efferentia, epididymis, and also the...
Okay, Rajiv, would you like to add something here?
Reproductive organs.
Rajiv, will you like to add something?
When we talk about primary, then we need to look at the development of the embryo as well. These gonads are the one which are formed at the beginning, right? And they take on the major role. So, in life of a sexually reproducing organism, these organs are utmost, because without these organs, gamete formation cannot take place, right?
Okay, can we simplify this as the primary sex organs are those where gametes and sex organs are produced. In case of males, it is testis. In case of females, it is the ovary. Can we say like this?
Yes.
Gautam?
That is the most simplest way to answer this one. Simply, we can say primary sex organs are those organs which produces gamete. In a single line, if you want to say. Hence, the gamete-producing organ in case of male as well as gamete-producing organ in case of females are the primary sex organs.
Right.
Next, all of the organs which are associated with reproduction, the process of reproduction, but do not produce gamete,
are
secondary sex organs.
Okay. Thank you. One more question. One of the students, they have mailed me right now. They wanted to know that when we are discussing reproduction, then one important term comes, that is sexual dimorphism. sexual dimorphism, and they want to know about secondary sex characters. Secondary sex organs, okay, and secondary sex characters. Yes. Will you please elaborate this sexual dimorphism and secondary sex characters?
Am I going to say this one? Hello?
Hello? Secondary sex characters?
Yes. See, secondary sex characters are those characters by which we can differentiate the male from the female. Okay? So, after puberty, you can say there are certain type of changes. Say, growth of hairs, suppose if we talk. So, say, mustache and beards in case of males, which we don't find in females. Okay? Growth of breasts, we don't find in case of males. Then Adam's apple, that is, we find the solid part in the male. Okay, larynx part, yeah. So like that, the voice, okay, low pitch voice and high pitch voice. Increase in the hip in case of females. Deposition of fats in thigh. So these are the changes which we find and by which we can discriminate a male from a female.
That means you want to say that these are certain morphological characters which helps one to identify a male and a female, right?
Yes.
When the dispersion of body hair is different.
Yes. Body hair pattern is also different. Yes, right.
Also,
so now I have suppose that it is very clear that these are those characters which can be visualized, which makes a male and a female different. So along with this, Rajiv, can you just throw light upon some the concept on sexual dimorphism?
The term itself is self-explanatory. Sexual dimorphy, two forms. Organism are distinctly male and female, yes. Right? And they are not identified in the childhood unless you see the external genitalia. But as they grow up, the body functions
at puberty, they are more differentiated.
Correct. The hormonal orchestra makes it more prominent. And as the person grows, they get characteristic curves, characteristic voice, characteristic hair pattern, so that makes differentiate between male and female.
Right.
Joke apart, fashion has made bridge the gap a bit, so people are keeping long hairs.
And that's correct. Now that becomes a point to be discussed. So one should not be confused with that, a male having a punk. Okay. That means if I say sexual dimorphism is male and female dimorphic. Two types, two morphologies of a male and a female, which identifies. As we can see in case of human male and human females are different. Similarly, in case of tiger and tigress, lion and lioness, peacock and hen. Am I right?
Yeah,
true.
So these also are examples of sexual dimorphism.
Am I correct? Dimorphism. Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, now this is a question for Dr. Majumdar. Please elaborate this different parts of the male reproductive system in brief for our students. Because I understand that this is a topic which students would like to know, because I have got many questions from them and they are interested to learn in details of the different parts. So because I have heard that some students, they are confused. They don't know that some of the secondary sex organs, whether it is in the males or in the females, this type of confusion also they have. So please elaborate the different parts of the male reproductive system in human.
Dr. Shah has rightly pointed out that these needs elaborated to dispel all myths and misconception, because otherwise that will be a problem in future life, and not only they can be misled, and that can not be good for them. So knowledge about this is very essential, and so that's why it is needed. So may I now share a screen to
yes. Elaborate. You can please go ahead.
Elaborate.
Yes. Please go ahead.
First of all, you see that the male reproductive system has the form. Major one, we have already discussed about the primary organ, the gonads, that is the testis, to produce and maintain and transport sperm. That is the very important feature, so that and produce this semen, the fluid. to discharge sperm within the female genital tract, as because we are organism with internal fertilization.
Right.
And we need to have copulatory organs, copulation, and like that.
Insemination.
And also, another most important thing, what Rajiv has previously mentioned, that these sex hormones, those are the most important orchestra that Rajiv has mentioned the term.
Mm-hmm.
The sex hormone, the androgen in case of male, the testosterone, yes, which are responsible for our secondary sexual characters and behaviors. So this is primarily the purpose of having male reproductive system.
Please elaborate, what are the different parts of the system?
Yes. If you go through the male reproductive system, you will get testes, and this is paired in that produces sperms and hormones. Testes are extra abdominal, that is most important in case of mammals. And this is to give protection to the developing sperm, which needs at least 2 to 3 degrees centigrade less temperature than the body temperature.
Okay.
For that reason, it is extra abdominal in nature. We have paired testes present within scrotal sac, scrotum, with a partial septum. In certain cases, here I have to mention that in certain cases, these testes remain, either both the testes or one testes remain undescendant, and that needs attention immediately, because that is called, what we call it as cryptosporidium undescended testes, because otherwise what will happen, they can lead to testicular cancer and infertility. That is most important. And also another thing is important in this aspect, that for testicular cancer, it's one of our major source of cancer, we need to use loose undergarment.
Yes.
So that this is heat production is less. Nowadays, under the influence of fashion and all that, very often
skin tight
we are deviating from that, and that leads to increment of testicular cancer. Besides these, there are accessory ducts like retitestis, okay, vas efferentia, vas deferens, then the ejaculatory ducts. These are the accessory ducts. If you go through the diagram, you'll find this
diagram is very important. Dr. Mujumdar,
yes.
This diagram is very important. Nah. It needs some elaboration.
Nah. Exactly. See that within the scrotal sac is surrounded by tunica vaginalis layer.
Yes.
And inside this, and there are three intermediate layer within that. Hmm. Okay, the parietal layer, the cavity, and the visceral layer. And inside you have one of the very most important feature, that is tunica albuginea. That acts as a, which divides the, what happened, this creates septum. You see, this is septum. Individual septum are created within the seminiferous tubules.
Yes. And globules are created.
So around 200 to 300 lobules are created, and in each lobules there are around 3 to 4 seminiferous tubules.
Okay.
Within the seminiferous tubules are the magic molecule, that is the germ cells, germinal epithelium cells, what is deployed in nature, which ultimately gives rise to the spermatogenesis. We'll discuss it in later.
Okay.
So these seminiferous tubules ultimately lead to straight tubules, these several ducts. And finally, they have an anastomosing network called retitestis. This retitestis is joining these seminiferous tubules with their vasa efferentia. And this vasa efferentia is the connector between these retitestes and this highly coiled epididymis. You see here, this epididymis has three parts: the head of the epididymis, the body of the epididymis, and the tail of the epididymis.
I think one question very frequently it is asked, that is the total duct system inside and outside the testis. So
exactly.
So that's it. That part has to be taken care. So
there's accessory ducts.
Yes.
And epididymis is very important for storage and maturation of spermatozoa.
Yes. Epididymis.
And so that ma'am, it can also acquire motility.
Yes.
And also it's seminal fluid to nourish the maturating. So you can easily understand that epididymis is a very important duct system.
Okay.
Vast difference from epididymis, it leads to the urethra, and they conveys sperm towards the urethra during sexual arousal. That is another very important feature. Stored sperm which are not ejaculated at the time of ejaculation. So that is again another very important feature of vas deferens. So if you go through here, you'll see that this is the ductus deferens. From epididymis, it goes to vas deferens here. So this diagram often comes, and students should know this in an elaborate fashion.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Majumdar. Okay. Please show this diagram, and this will be.
This epididymis, the vas deferentia will come to the open here in seminiferous tubules. There are, you see, these seminal vesicles, seminal vesicles. These are accessory duct, and they too open. And in a urethra, near the prostatic urethra.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And from there, it goes to the muscular urethra. This is the external genitalia, that is the penis, which has a root, a body, and a head part. The head part is covered with the foreskin, prepuce. And within these, there are erectile tissues. Yes. And two terms here, you are seeing muscles, this corpus cavernosum and corpus cavernosum and spongiosum. They contain blood vessels. And during the time of sexual arousal, blood rushes in. But the speed it rushes in, goes back in the same speed, that leads to erectibility of the penis.
We find one interesting thing, that is the urethra, that is here in case of males, the urethra is a common passage for the sperms. And the
common urinary genital duct is urethra, yes. But the point is that it is neurally controlled.
Yes, neurally controlled.
During the time of semen discharge, you will not get urination.
Yes, right. Rightly said. This is very important.
That is important. Vice versa.
Question very frequently asked by the students, whether both of them can go side by side. Thank you.
No.
So this is not possible. It is neural control. Okay, now
I believe the accessory male reproductive gland will be separated.
Dr. Majumdar, will come to you again. Dr. Mahindra,
yes. Yes. Okay, yes. So I'm not sharing my screen.
Mr. Gautam Biswas, this is a question for you. Our viewers have asked to describe the female reproductive system in brief. So please go ahead with this. At least the different parts of the female reproductive system. Please elaborate. Mr. Biswas.
Hello, Abhijit.
Yes.
Dr. Shah, the screen is visible, I think so.
It is visible.
Yes.
Okay. Now, basically, if we want to start with the female reproductive system, initially we have given a question about the primary reproductive system, primary sex organ, secondary sex organ, where this is also over here. Anyway, we are coming towards the female reproductive system. Let's have, first of all, an overall view. What are the structures present over there? Okay. So this is a concept map, which had been developed by taking all the points in view that what are the structures associated with the female reproductive system.
Okay, fine.
So starting with one end, the ovaries. Okay. The ovaries followed by the oviduct or the fallopian tube. The fallopian tube further is broadly divided into three parts. We'll come with the diagram also. So for time being, I'm just highlighting the points. The part is first infundibulum, which is the funnel-shaped structure, followed by ampulla, a zone where fertilization generally takes place, and isthmus, where it joins with the uterus. Okay, that's the isthmus is a junction, rather, we can say. It actually connects the fallopian tube along with the uterus. The infundibulum, it has some finger-like projections, and these are called as fimbriae. Well, if you come towards the uterus, it is a pear-shaped structure and it is made up of three different layers, the endometrium, myometrium and the perimetrium. So coming from the outer side, the outer layer is called as the perimetrium, middle layer is called as myometrium. The word myo, you know, it's smooth muscles is over here, so it's a highly muscular. And this is called myometrium, and the endometrium layer, the thickness over there, it increases and decreases. That is in the cyclic changes that occurs. We can go to the part of the next session.
Okay.
And uterus has an opening, a narrow opening, which contains a very strong splinter muscle. I think the strongest splinter muscle in female body is in cervix. Now this opens to a tube or a canal, which is called as birth canal or vagina. Next, the vagina opens to the external genitalia, which consists of labia majora or the larger lip, labia minora or the smaller lip, and a small organ which is similar with that of the male penis, that is the clitoris, and a cushion of fatty tissue where hair grows, an area called as mons pubis.
Right.
So these are the things which are associated with the female reproductive system. Okay.
Even can you show the diagram? Can you show the diagram for explanation?
Yes. We are coming towards it.
Okay.
Now here the points have been given. Now this is a sectional view.
Okay.
And the sectional view, if you start from the ovary, you can see over here small finger-like structures, and it comes and joins to the uterus, having cervix.
Can you simplify diagram?
Okay. A simpler diagram here we are having.
This one, I think this one is a very simple diagram, I suppose. Yes.
Yes. This is a diagram which shows which is the exact location of the female reproductive system. So here a model had been given and the parts had been shown. In one case, that ovary is shown in transverse section, showing the fimbriae. You can see over here infundibulum, ampulla and isthmus, the level is over here, but it shows the junction part. The uterus had been made a section and shown the wall of endometrium, myometrium and perimetrium. The internal os and external os are os, actually they are the opening, and in between the cervical canal, all together it is called as the cervix. Next, followed by the vagina, the external genitalia is not given over here. Now, moving towards the ovaries, this can be also discussed later on, but a sectional view shows that it contains some primordial follicle.
We'll discuss it later.
Over here, just I'm showing the structures, means the reproductive system starts with ovary,
okay,
its function, production of gamete, okay, followed by the fallopian tube, which is generally 10 to 12 centimeter length in average in an adult normal human being, and the diameter is less than 1 centimeter.
Okay.
It is lined with ciliated epithelium. Okay. That is the transfer of the.
We'll come to you again.
Then
you start. Okay. Yes? Now, in short, please, I'd like to go to Rajiv. Mr. Rajiv.
Yeah. Audible.
Now, a question for you now. This is your student who is asking to describe the structure of the seminiferous tubule. Means the TS of seminiferous tubule, the structure. Would you please elaborate this?
Yeah, definitely. It's one of the most important question, and diagrams are the soul of biology. So I think.
Please.
I'll just come to that. I'll just start the broadcast. One second. Let me.
I can give you 3 minutes time for this.
One second. I came to the, well, this is.
I'm talking of seminiferous tubules.
Yes, yeah, definitely. Let me bring my slide.
Okay, yes, I think got it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
yes. So if we talk about the testis, as Dr. Sabyasachi has already explained, it's the most important organ, and it is divided into compartments.
Internal structure. Now you have to go into the details of internal structure of the seminiferous.
Yes. So when we take a TS of a testis, there are several structures which are very, very important. It talks about the functionality of a testis. First of all, you will find that the tubules are circular in outline, more or less. And when you look into it, you will find three types of thing inside. Outermost, there is a peritoneum which covers it, and then you find there are three types of cells, pretty distinct. There are bigger cells called Sertoli cells, and a part of that, you will find there is a basement membrane.
Can you show me in last figure? Hello?
Yes.
Can you show me last figure? Please enlarge it. Yes, yes. Okay, now it is okay.
Okay. So you can find in the seminiferous tubule, there are some germinal epithelium lying that we call as spermatogonial cell or stem cell, which are the progenitor for the spermatozoa. In between, you can find some taller cells, which are nothing but your Sertoli cells or nurse cells. And in between this tubule, you can find another group of cell clearly visible. They are called as Sertoli cells, Leydig cells. So these Leydig cells are also very important. So this diagram comes very handy when we talk about the overall function of male reproductive system. Let me come to the role one by one. When we talk about these germinal epithelium cells, they are the one which forms spermatogonia, and you can find various stages here out. I'll come to the next diagram where I think it will be more clear.
Please.
Yeah. If you take a sectional view,
yes, this
what you can find here.
This is a understood.
Yes, very, very clear.
Yes.
Very, very clear. So at the basement membrane, you will find spermatogonial cells. These cells are dividing, and they divide meiotically to form primary spermatocyte. You can find here itself. And primary spermatocyte again forms secondary spermatocyte. Secondary spermatocyte, when that divides the meiosis II, it forms spermatids, which is transformed into spermatozoa. So,
no, fantastic. There is a sequence being followed here. Steps of spermatogenesis also, which we'll be discussing later on.
Correct. It will.
You have given a very, very nice diagram where, along with the various steps of spermatogenesis, it can be elaborated. So, this is a nice diagram for this purpose. Anything more you want to say?
Yeah, I think this sequence is very, very important. But once we come to spermatogenesis, that will be more clear. Because while making this, the labeling must not be wrong.
Right, right.
In 2018, a question came, you have to make a sectional diagram of testis showing any six part. And that carried 3 marks.
Right. So at that time, this diagram which you have just shown is more than sufficient, I suppose.
Yes.
Okay, that's good. I think we are now running out of time, running short. Okay. Hello.
Hello.
Now,
hello.
We are running short of time.
Okay.
Okay. So we have to take a break. and then it will be resumed after the break. Welcome after the break. Before going for the break, we had discussed different topics like primary sex organs, secondary sex organs. We discussed on secondary sex characters, discussed on sexual dimorphism. Our panel experts, they have already discussed on these. And also different parts of the male and female reproductive system. Our panelists today, Dr. Subhasachi Mujumdar, Mr. Gautam Biswas, Mr. Rajiv Ranjan Singh, they have been explaining all these issues raised by our students. Now we continue with this. Our next topic to be discussed is, I would like to request Dr. Mujumdar to throw some light on, sir, the accessory glands, male accessory glands. If you can just discuss what are these and the importance in the reproductive system. Dr. Mujumdar.
Yes, yes.
Okay, please.
So, go back to this slide, you can see that there are accessory glands beside the main is testes and other accessory ducts. We have paired seminal vesicle, very important gland.
Okay.
Then you have a prostate through which the urethra pass, prostatic urethra. And beyond this, we have this bulbourethral glands or Cowper's gland. So the glands are of.
I think, sir, I'll just interrupt you for a moment. There is confusion between the students. There is confusion in the students between this bulbourethral glands and Bartholin's gland. So I think here the students frequently make mistakes.
Here the students. Okay, so this Cowper's gland, that will be better told because then confusion will be less. Okay, Cowper's gland. Mm-hmm. So here you see, if you go through it, seminal vesicles, as I told you, they are paired structure and they're so important because they contribute around 60% of the semen.
Right.
And this is located, as I've shown you, this is a pouch-like structure in the posterior part of the urinary bladder, and they are secreting alkaline viscous fluid. But this is very important because they contain fructose, which is a nutritive structure, and also this fructose is essential for ATP production in sperm. That is to be noted. That is a very, very important point.
Any other importance of this fructose? Because fructose is a disaccharide found in plants.
Yes, yes. So, but it has been off late, the journal suggests that it has its role, indirect role in ATP production in sperm.
Okay.
Sperm motility, ATP is very important. So that way you cannot just, previously we always talk about fructose as nutrition. Nutritive.
Right.
But this recent journal shows that this is also plays a major role in ATP production in sperm. Then we have this lipid equivalent structure, these prostaglandins, which helps in sperm motility, and also in female reproductive tract, smooth muscle contraction. So during during contraception is very important. And also, these coagulating proteins, you know, semen after discharge gets coagulated.
Right.
That because of this coagulating protein. So, seminal vesicle has a very important role in semen formation and in reproduction. Then I have told about the prostate glands. It's just inferior to the bladder. And as I've told you, it is surrounding the prostatic urethra. It's slightly alkaline, milky fluid containing citric acid, proteolytic enzymes, lysozymes, PSA, that is very important. prostate specific antigen. Hyaluronidase, as you know, this sperm lysine.
Yes, yes, sperm lysine, yes.
And there is another very important thing, that is antimicrobial substances are off late found. Journal suggests antimicrobial antibiotics are present in prostate secretion, which helps kills the bacteria. So it neutralizes the acidity of the vas deferens and vagina, helps in prostate, in sperm motility. But the point I mentioned just before also, that prostate is off. You have to add something while teaching, giving prostate, because prostate malignancy is the second most death after lung cancer in male in many of the countries.
That is going to say about PSA tests, which should be done.
Prostatomegaly is very important, and previously we usually remain undiagnosed, or it onset after 55-60, but nowadays even in 40s we are seeing prostatomegaly, maybe benign prostatomegaly, and if it is untreated it may lead to prostate cancer. So students must know it, and prostate specific antigen test is a surer test beside clinical observation to determine if PSA level is high. You must have to take care. So that is another important gland. And Cowper's gland, it's inferior to the posterior, as I've shown you just. They have alkaline in nature. They neutralize the acidity of urine. And also, they helps in the sperm motility, especially during sexual arousal. Besides, they have mucus secretion. They stimulate mucus secretion in the glans penis region of the male, which helps acts as a lubricant during intercourse.
Okay. So these thank you, Dr.
This is very important.
One important information which you have given, that is regarding PSA. This is really very, very important nowadays. And this will be helpful for the students. They should know. And also for those students, those who are aspiring for medical or something like this, this additional information will be helpful to them. Now I'd like to go to Mr. Gautam Biswas.
Yes.
Yes. We were discussing the female reproductive system. Can you just elaborate in brief the structure of the ovary? Though we'll be coming to
later on. Obviously.
We'll be going to oogenesis. By this time, can you just throw some light upon the structure of the ovary? Because the structure of the ovary is a very, very important question for the students also. So they should understand the structure. So please, can you show me the diagram with a sperm illustration?
Sure. Dr. Abhijit, before moving towards it, taking prior permission from Dr. Sabasachi Majumdar, sir, I would like to add a small thing about the fructose which you have added in the last topic. The fructose is not found in any other, means not in female body. It is only found in male body.
Yes.
And that is one of the important criteria, important test to investigate, preliminary investigation of rape
cases.
Okay. So that is to be kept in mind. It is in only in male's body and not in female's body. That information may also be given to the students for additional information.
That's great.
This is important.
Let's add towards the screen sharing part and the next topic about the structure of ovary. Well, I think the screen is visible.
No.
Abhijit, sir, is the screen visible?
No.
It is not visible.
Beauty of monospermia is visible.
That's a good.
Beauty of monospermia is visible. Just a minute. Yes.
Sharing has been given.
Share ya niche. Niche share ya.
Yes, Gautam is sharing now, please. Hmm. Yes, show me this slide number 18. Yes, structure of the ovary.
Yeah.
Yeah, this one.
Now, this is actually a section of ovary, which is showing the growth of primordial follicle. Okay, in oogenesis, we'll come to know about the primordial follicle. These follicles are actually produced at the fetal stage, and they slowly grow into primary follicle, secondary follicle, and Graafian follicle. Rather, this process had not been mentioned in NCERT, but it is also called as folliculogenesis. Okay. Now we'll come to words folliculogenesis a little later in this one only. Now what happens? Let's just say about it. When the follicle grows, they develop a chamber inside which fills a fluid. The chamber is called as antrium. Okay. And during this, there are certain cells which produces a hormone, the female sex hormone, that is estrogen. And this, all this activity, actually the development of this takes place after puberty. So how? After puberty, the hormone, that is FSH, is actually released from anterior pituitary, which actually stimulates the primordial follicle.
Mr. Biswas,
yes,
we'll discuss more in details while discussing the oogenesis part.
Yes,
here also the stages of oogenesis are visible. Okay.
Yes.
Just give me the idea of the structure. We'll discuss.
Okay.
We'll come again in oogenesis.
Okay. Now, if we see about the structures of that, we can say that they are paired. Okay. Unlike your testes, which was extra abdominal, they are intra abdominal. Okay. And each is of 2 to 3 centimeter in length, and we can just divide the part into cortex, a part. Okay, which is the bulk of an adult ovary. And the other is the stroma, and oocytes developed within the outer layer of the stroma, okay, which is surrounded by supporting cells. Now, this supporting cells along with the oocyte is called as a follicle.
Okay.
So follicle is basically a mass of cell, and inside it contains a oocyte. That means the secondary oocyte, which will be formed. Now, this formation, that means the growth of this follicle from primary to secondary to tertiary, or which we call as Graafian follicle, is called as folliculogenesis. Now, how do we differentiate between the different follicles? If you want to see, then the primordial follicles are present in newborn. They have only a single flat layer of supporting cells called granulosa cells. The cells which surround them are called as granulosa cells. We'll come to the slide after again. After puberty, they turn into immature growing follicle called as primary follicle. Primary follicle consists of single layer of granulosa cell again, but the cells are much more developed. This granulosa cell divides and forms to secondary follicle. This special cells, thicker cells, which surrounds the granulosa cells, they produce estrogen. Okay. And later on, a thick fluid which deposits inside a chamber, the chamber is called antrum. Now the fully formed structure is called as a Graafian follicle.
Okay, one thing I find very important, that is the thicker cells. There is no mention of thicker cells.
Yes.
But in general, yes, the students understand, they know that it is the ovary which produces the...
No, there are specific cells over there.
Sex hormone. But here, yes, it has been specified which cells of the ovary. That's good. Fine.
Yeah, I'll show you one more diagram, just a few minutes. Now, this is a primordial follicle. You can see the cells over here, granulosa cells, but the cells are few in number and not well developed. In second case, you can find the granulosa cells. And during this time, the zona pellucida layer also develops.
Okay.
Now, next is the, over here, you can see the thicker cells are outside. Then the blue one over here is the granulosa cells. Okay. The secondary, the oocyte nucleus and the oocyte inside, which is covered by zona pellucida.
Okay.
So this comes secondary follicle, develops into tertiary follicle inside. Now the thing is, the magnification over here had been reduced in order to keep the size same.
Okay.
So the oocyte size is small over here, and you can see the antrum, the chamber over here.
Yes.
And after ovulation, the secondary oocyte is released. The ruptured follicle now is called as corpus luteum, or the yellow body. Okay,
that's
the structure over here.
That's fine.
Just I would like to add over here, this particular structure which the students actually see in practical, and they try to identify.
Wonderful slide. This is
wonderful. This is a slide.
Yes.
TS of ovary.
TS of ovary.
And you can see the growing follicles over here. This is also going to be matured, but this is the matured one. Its size is quite large enough. Can see the secondary oocyte, zona pellucida layer, corona radiata. Okay, the cells had been detached from this, and granulosa cells, and the large chamber antrum. Right. Okay, this the thicker cells are actually outside, which is not leveled over here. So this is in general the structure of ovary.
Yes, yes, that was a wonderful presentation, and the various parts also, this is very clear. And I think with this, the students will be able to understand the different parts of the ovary. The structure of the ovaries was quite clear. Now, to continue with this, may I ask Mr. Rajiv? Mr. Rajiv?
Here, just a second. You can see over here the thicker cells where it is located.
Okay, okay.
Is the skin visible?
Yes, it is visible. Oocyte,
zona pellucida, grana, and the thicker cells.
Right.
Okay. Okay, just I'm stopping the screen sharing mode.
Okay, thank you. Now I'll go to Mr. Rajiv Singh. Rajiv, please.
Yes, sir.
In continuation with the structure of the ovary, I'd like you to come up with oogenesis. Let it continue.
Yes, yeah, sure.
The later part of the oogenesis, so please continue.
I'll just take 1 minute to share a slide so that I can get going with the spontaneity that Gautam sir has set up.
Okay.
In that time, with prior permission to, can I add one thing?
Please,
that is,
please do.
That initially many follicle cells starts developing. After it is arrested.
Yes.
That is to be added. That much.
I think Rajiv will be dealing with this oogenesis. I think he is expected
and that corpus luteum. We can even extend up to corpus albicans.
Albicans, yes.
Yes, yes.
Corpus luteum only progesterone should be added. Okay.
Yes. That's what Rajiv discussed.
The presentation was really excellent.
Then we can...
Thank you, sir.
Rajiv, yes.
Yes, I'm sharing the screen. Let it come. Oogenesis, as the term says, the two terms, oo and genesis, formation of ovum.
Okay.
Ovum formation. So it includes a sequence of event, and as you can see, it was beautifully explained by Gautam sir. What is happening? We all are aware that the oogenesis is a long process. It starts with the fetal life.
Yes.
Right. The diagram which is depicted here out is just representation from ovum formation from germinal epithelium. But let us go back a bit and take a brief recap, because there are a lot of confusing areas, gray areas. Students are finding difficult to comprehend the same. What is happening here? At the fourth week time, the primordial germ cells, they migrate towards the developing ovary and form oogonial cell, right? And as sir already said, that oogonial cells, they are surrounded by follicular cells. So student also need to know what is the importance of these follicular cells. Follicles are enveloped. So why do they envelop these oogonial cells? I'll make it very clear that these follicular cell secretes a special protein, oocyte maturation inhibitor, because it arrests the oogenesis at the fetal life.
Oh, this is very Rajiv, thank you. This is a very important part which you have said, because the students may ask the question. Why should this, there should be arresting of the formation of oogonia?
Correct. So, what happens out of that oogonial cells? Few cells start or take a decision to enter the meiosis, and they form primary oocyte. Right? And primary oocyte, that is arrested in the prophase 1. Right, to be very specific, in the diplotene stage of prophase 1. So, what happens? These all stage formation ends by 5th month of the fetal development. Then, the thing continues after puberty. As I have already mentioned, when the hormonal orchestra begins, then the next phase starts. So, what happens? First of all, the primary oocyte that grows in size and single layer of follicular cell surrounds it, which is called as primordial follicle. Correct. So, at puberty, when the menstruation starts, menstrual cycle starts, 15 to 20 primordial follicle starts maturating. 15 to 20. So there is a race. And out of which only one will be allowed to develop. And rest degenerates. Follicular atresia. The phenomenon is called as follicular atresia. Yes. So now what is happening? The primary oocyte grows in size. And the follicular cells, which was squamous, now becomes cuboidal. It grows in size. And then it starts forming primary follicle. There are layers which are being added. And I'll tell you the medullary reason. What you find, there are some cells in the stroma which surrounds these follicle. And that develops into theca, theca folliculi, right? Mm-hmm. Which further differentiates into theca externa and theca interna. So the origin of the theca is from the stromal cell. It's the connective tissue, right? In the meantime, the number of cells also increases in the follicle and it starts secreting a protein. And that protein forms another layer covering the oocyte, still the primary oocyte. Primary oocyte, and that layer is a very crystal transparent layer, which is called as zona pellucida. Another confusion that is normally dealt while labeling, zona pellucida, from where does it come from? So it is a product from the follicular cells. Follicular cells produces zona pellucida. Now, zona pellucida is a barrier between oocyte at this stage, not ovum, oocyte and the follicular cell. That's another confusion that student talks about. Whether ovum is produced, when it is produced. So up till now, it is at primary oocyte level. Rajiv,
now I think we have discussed this part. Gautam has discussed in at length. Now, should we go up to the stages of oogenesis?
Yeah, definitely. So, it is part of oogenesis only. Mm-hmm. Then, as the follicular cell start producing the fluid-filled chambers, small packets, so antrum formation starts. And when this starts, secondary follicle is being formed, and that is the impetus signal for now the primary oocyte to continue with the further meiotic division. So now what happens? The primary oocytes is converted into secondary oocyte and a polar body. I repeat, secondary oocyte and a polar body.
Okay, Rajiv, can you show any schematic diagram so that students will understand better the schematic diagram of oogenesis? Because here I will have ask you, here there is a confusion between in the students regarding two things. Are you listening to me? Hello, Rajiv?
Yes, I'm listening. I'm just moving the
screen. I have a question for you. It's not mine, but I have got a message that is, students want to know or they how to relate these terms, because there's confusion between primary oocyte, primary follicles, secondary oocyte, secondary follicle. So they are very much confused. What are these and how are they related? When you are talking of the structure of the ovary, we are using these terms: primary follicles, secondary follicles, tertiary follicles, and graafian follicles, and so on. But when we are talking of oogenesis, there we don't talk of these follicles; rather, we talk of primary oocyte, secondary, and the stages of formation of the ovum. Okay, so now we are going to our time.
It is very simple.
Please discuss.
Very, very, very. I'll take very little time to make it clear. Very simple to identify when we talk about primordial follicle. When we talk about primordial follicle, it is just a primary oocyte along with a layer of cells. Then, as it increases to it matures to primary follicle. Then the number of cells increases in the follicular layer, it forms secondary follicle. At this stage only, when antrum formation starts, the signal for meiosis 2 comes. And then primary oocyte is converted into secondary oocyte and a polar body. So that is the one side. When we look at the graafian follicle, there you will find the oocyte is in secondary stage. It is secondary oocyte. It is not the primary oocyte. And still it is surrounded by follicular cells. at ovulation, when ovulation takes place, this ovum, oocyte, is released along with some stromal cell, and that is called as corona radiata. So now the drama begins again, ki when fertilization approaches and a sperm head enters corona radiata, moves to zona pellucida, then the stimulus for secondary oocyte to continue the further meiotic division. And at that point only, what happens? The secondary oocyte divides into another polar body and ovum. So it is only at the time of fertilization that meiosis completes. That's why I said it's a long process. It started in the fetal time, and now at the time of fertilization only, the oocyte is converted into ovum. So I guess this is one area which will make the student very clear that it is ovum which comes only when the time for fertilization reaches.
Okay, I think our time is over today. Okay, whatever discussion left, we'll continue in our next meeting. And now I'd like to thank all of you for being with us or being together in discussing this important aspect. Let us continue in the part two session of human reproduction. And likewise, we'll continue in other chapters also.